Before I start my paper, I should like to inform you that I have a small stammer, so sometimes I get stuck in a sentence. So just stay with me when that happens, please. The title of my paper is Human Rights Challenging Extremism. It might as well have been entitled Extremism Challenging Human Rights. For extremism is one of the most complex and difficult issues that the human rights community has to tackle in its 21st century. There is no clear definition in a human rights context of what actually constitutes extremism. But focus has in particular been on violent extremism, and especially such which is linked to terrorism. Violent extremism undermines peace, security, and human rights. From a human rights perspective, it's therefore very simple that it's paramount to fight extremism. But it's not so simple how to fight extremism, because the danger is that in the process of destroying extremism, you also destroy or damage human rights. So when we approach the triangle of extremism, human rights, and religion, the state has an obligation to protect individuals and groups from hostility, discrimination, and violence because of their religion or belief. The state has an obligation to interfere, whether it's secular extremists or if it is religious extremists that cause such hostility, discrimination, or violence. But what if there is no act of discrimination or violence, but just talk about it? Here we come to one of the most controversial issues in human rights debates. And this is what I'm going to focus on today because it's particularly relevant to religious dialogues. So not only is violence prohibited according to international human rights standards, so is incitement or encouragement to such violence. This principle was laid down in the UN Covenant on Civil and Political Rights as early as 1966. The covenant prohibits any advocacy of national or racial or religious hatred, which constitutes incitements to discrimination, hostility, or violence. So the big challenge from a human rights perspective is that by fighting incitement to, for instance, religiously founded discrimination, hostility, or violence, the state may have to limit the full enjoyment of human rights. According to international human rights standards, limitation of people's full enjoyment of rights should be as few as possible. Moreover, such limitations must be justifiable according to human rights standards, which primarily means that they have to be necessary for achieving a particular aim, for instance, to protect individuals and groups against incitements or hatred. The principle of necessity implies that certain restrictive measures by the state on, for instance, freedom of expression is not justifiable if it's actually reasonable, if it's possible to reach the same goal by less means. So therefore, also restrictions have to be very precise and accurate. They must not be too broad. For instance, if a state limits freedom of expression extremely severely, it may actually foster extremism instead of countering extremism. There's a big debate about at the moment what is necessary and what is justifiable when it comes to the state limiting human rights, especially freedom of expression and freedom of religion in order to foster a society free of incitements to hatred and violence. This is, for instance, the case in Denmark at the moment. The debate is about whether to focus on freedom, freedom to say what you want and believe what you want, or to focus on protection of the individual, the group, and society from incitement to hatred and violence. This debate is played out at different local levels, for instance in Denmark and many other European countries outside Europe, in the different regions of the world. It is also played out in the international arena. So this question about freedom or protection has been carried out at different levels, for instance at the international level. And especially interesting is what took place in the UN Human Rights Council. The UN Human Rights Council is a council of states, so it's at the level of government. From 1999 to 2010, the Organization of Islamic Cooperation, OIC, presented annual resolutions on defamation of religion. It should be prohibited to slander religion. One of the underlying reasons behind these resolution proposals was that OIC saw discrimination of and hostility towards Muslims in the Western world. And they linked that to the slander of religion. Therefore, according to OIC, blasphemy law could come into place. Generally speaking, the Western countries represented in the Human Rights Council, they saw the defamation of religion issue as a blow both to freedom of religion and freedom of expression. And from a strict human rights perspective, you can say that the Western countries was in a fairly strong position because the UN Human Rights Committee had given a general comment where it stresses very much that blasphemy laws are incompatible with the Human Rights Covenant except in the specific circumstances envisioned in Article 20, Paragraph 2 of the Covenant. However, this Article 20 exactly concerns incitements to hatred, and that's what OIC said, but it's actually to fight all these incitements to discrimination and hatred that we want these defamation of religion statutes. And therefore, it's also interesting to observe that actually OIC, they didn't say that they didn't want human rights. They just interpreted human rights in a different way from the US and Europe. So it is all taking place within the framework of human rights. Okay, so for 10 years, this dichotomy between the Western world and OIC were carried out in the framework on the UN Human Rights Council. But then something very interesting happened in 2011. Actually, two documents saw the day that both are represented attempts to bridge the conflict between OIC and the Western countries. The first one is the Human Rights Council Resolution 1618 on combating intolerance and discrimination and incitement to violence against persons based on religion and belief. This resolution was and is still considered a landmark in the work of the UN Human Rights Council and was a successful result of the combined efforts of the OIC and Europe and the US. What is particularly interesting in our context is that this resolution promotes more freedom than restriction. Notably, freedom of expression is seen as a useful tool to combat hate speech, religious intolerance, and violence. The resolution underlines the role of exactly interfaith and intercultural dialogue for combating intolerance. And more broadly, the resolution also underlines the importance of a free public debate at the local, national, and international level in order to protect against religious intolerance. In other words, the resolution signals that good speech can prevent and conquer bad speech and actions. But the resolution also calls for a clear rejection of certain speech acts and condemns any advocacy of religious hatred that constitute incitement to discrimination, hostility, and violence. But what about criminalizing such speech acts? Here, the resolution calls for measures to criminalize incitement to imminent violence based on religion or belief. This paragraph is a main point of disagreement between the state and has been for several years. Again, it can for instance see that it's for instance obvious that there are different interpretations of how imminent should it be before the state criminalizes behavior. And again, you can see a dichotomy between freedom and the protection is at stake, and that there are very strong disagreement among states. One of the things that the states have had difficulties in agreeing on is in finding criteria to determine when a certain speech act actually is so serious that it should be criminalized. Okay, so what are the criteria that the states should use when they determine whether a speech act is so seriously harmful that it should be criminalized? This was a question that the governments couldn't agree on. This brings me to a second important document, the Rabat Plan of Action. And that's also from 2011, and it was the Office of the UN Human Rights Commissioner who organized a series of experts workshops. So now we're not at the level of the state, but on experts. And they, not surprisingly, are more progressive and more come with some more concrete action plans. And that is exactly what they did. They made an action plan with quite elaborate suggestions to the states. And one of the things they suggest is that you actually use a set of criteria which, for instance, a national court can be employing when the court has to assess whether a speech act is a criminal offense. And there are six criteria that the Rabat Plan of Action recommends to be followed. First, you should look at whether at the social and political context of the speech act. Second, you should look at the speaker, at his or her status in society and the community, his or her influence. Third, the intent of the speech act. Is it something which the speaker actually really meant, or was it a mere negligence? Fourth, its content or style. For instance, there can be a strong degree of provocation in the wording that are used, or there can be more gentle wording. Fifth, the extent of the speech act. For instance, is it a public gathering that the speech act has been conducted in with a big audience, or is it just in a small room with two or three people? That can also have an effect. And sixth, the likelihood and imminence of actually causing harm in society or towards individuals or groups because of the speech act. So these six criteria are suggested to the UN Human Rights Council that they actually adopt these and actually make the states adopt these in their national legislation. And positively, I think it has actually, to some extent, it has been decided in the UN Human Rights Council to actually look into the Rabat Plan of Action. So therefore, you can see the last few years, every year, the UN Human Rights Council reconfirms Resolution 1618, say that it will still work for this resolution. And then for the last few years, it has actually mentioned the Rabat Plan of Action. So that is, from a human rights point of perspective, it's a positive thing that it seems to be taken rather seriously in the Human Rights Council. But how seriously is it actually taken by the UN Human Rights Council and by the states who subscribe to this resolution? This is, of course, a completely different matter. But I think, as a starting point, it's actually positive that at the state level you find some agreement that you should try to find extremism, but without undermining human rights, especially freedom of expression and freedom of religion. You should not underestimate such public and international pronouncements. But of course, it depends on how do you actually, in the different countries, at the concrete level, implement, if you at all implement, the Resolution 1618 and the Rabat Plan of Action. And here you can see a great diversity in the different countries, and of course a very long way to go still. I find it here useful, because we don't have so much time, to actually refer to the UN Special Rapporteur on Freedom of Religion or Belief, Heiner Bielefeld, because he is an independent expert who both have been working on the different resolutions, have been on different country visits, and have been in constant dialogue with both states, civil society, religious leaders, etc. So therefore, his observations and recommendations and different recommendations are, from a human rights perspective, expressing very much the norms of human rights. He has given a lot of recommendations as far as fighting extremism especially religious extremism without undermining human rights. I will limit myself to three observations made by the Special Rapporteur. First, according to Heiner Bielefeld, some states are too quick to pass criminal legislation in their fight against religious intolerance, violence, and incitement to hatred. He recommends that states in far greater measure explore the potential of communication and dialogue before using criminal law as a tool to fight hatred and extremism. Second, the Special Rapporteur very strongly urges states who still have blasphemy laws to repeal these laws, as, in his words, such laws may fuel intolerance, stigmatization, discrimination, and incitement to violence and discourage intergroup communication. Third, the Special Rapporteur recommends the diversity, or he is praising the diversity of formats in which inter-religious dialogues are taking place. And he very much sees inter-religious dialogues as a tool to counter extremism and without undermining human rights. He therefore very much recommends dialogues such as these. He also recommends that religious dialogues increasingly focus on more inclusiveness. For instance, he says that women are often underrepresented in different inter-religious projects, which we also heard one of the speakers this morning said also had a negative effect in the present situation. And equally, he also recommends the internal diversity of position, and he also encouraged that more dialogue between religious community and secular communities are also included, so that it doesn't appear in society that we have the different religions on one side and the secular society on one side. So these are some of his recommendations, and of course it's something that's going to be interesting to see over the next decades, how different states are actually fighting extremism. And I would just like to finish by saying that this debate about fighting extremism without undermining human rights takes actually different forms and are quite fluid from different regions to different regions. And you can also see historically that the discourse changes place, so to speak. So for instance, Europe and the United States used to be in favor of very extensive enjoyment of freedom of religion and freedom of expression, as for instance in Denmark during the cartoon crisis. And therefore the US and Europe stood in very strong opposition to Islamic states. But now Europe, in increasing extent, call for limitation of freedom of speech in order to fight what is seen as especially Islamic extremism. I hope that by this paper I have showed that dialogue such as the one we have today and tomorrow from a human rights point of view has a huge potential to contribute to the fight against extremism without undermining human rights. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Eva Maria Lassen, thank you. And I now understand that our colleagues have fixed the technical problems concerning equipment, is that true? On the last part, thank you. So now we invite Mr. Wajie Kansu to make a short comment or a question. That's fine. And then afterwards you are welcome to make a short response. Thank you. Maybe you should come up here, Eva Maria.
Regarding the topic of human rights and extremism, the speaker was speaking from the legal level that certain regulations and rules must be adopted and monitored and applied by the state in general. But once we come to the Middle East, the story will be a different one, because when we speak of human rights, the state itself is the main source of human rights violations. So many human rights violations are part of the culture, are justifiable one way or another, whether in a cultural way, religious way. At many points, you can see that extremism is not anti-human right issue. At many times, you can see that extremism is a consequence of the state's violation when an individual feels he's threatened, his dignity. Is humiliated, and he doesn't see any future horizon there for his future. One of the ways is to resort to extremism. He doesn't resort to extremism, actually. He resorts to religion in general. He feels kind of something that would compensate the insecurity that he feels in society, in life. So he resorts to religion, and this thing starts to develop, and at the moment it comes up to become like takes a form of ideology, and this ideology calls for, to practice certain violence there. So at many times extremism is a consequence. This is the main point here. Now, the question becomes, I will not say that we don't fight extremism, but I mean, what will lead to extremism and what can be done for extremism to show up at a certain, social life or political life and doesn't show somewhere else. So there are some economical, social, political conditions that extremism is becoming a consequence or a product of it, one way or another. So the whole question in the Middle East, in the Arab world probably, is not the legal issue, because so many resolutions have been adopted and there is no change there, because the idea of human rights is not well rooted in the social awareness, in the individual awareness, in the culture. There is kind of a culture that needs some reformation, let's say. It's not bad, but it needs to be updated, to be modernized, let's say. So the process is not there. There is no process. The state is only worried about how to preserve power and how to protect itself from the people themselves. So the whole question becomes different there, and it's not a legal issue. So how, at least you as an activist and been involved in such debate, how this thing been dealt with? Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I think that you are very, very right in talking about the other root causes for extremism. And that's actually, now I was only speaking about hate speech and incitement to violence, but actually within the human rights regime, you try to address extremism by economic, social, political, civil rights. So for instance, health rights and poverty and education, all these kind of things. So from the human rights world point of view, you try to address these things, and you, from the UN perspective, you try to actually get the whole world into the human rights family and try to negotiate different human rights also as part of the fight against extremism. And I think some people are very critical towards that process because they think that then everybody just talks about human rights but nothing actually happens. But that's is one of the ways I think that it is actually governed in the UN at the moment. But I think that from a human rights perspective, extremism is very much addressed from different economic, social, political, civil society factors.